Thank you, Susie. We're up for Susie. Forty years. It's a long time. I want to take you back 10 years beyond that, to about 1966, when the Rolling Stones were just breaking out of that blues cover band thing. They were just sort of starting to take the world on. Imagine if in 1966 you became cryogenically frozen. 50 years later, you were awoken to this world now. Okay, I'll pretend it's me that's getting woken up. And so my nurse is sort of pretty hip. And I ask her, what's number one on the hit parade? She gets out this black thing, presses a few buttons, and she says, it's a Rolling Stones blues covers album. And what would you think? Nothing's changed. But then I'd say, what's that black thing? She'd say, it's my telephone. I'd go, whoa, that's new. How could you find that information out on your telephone? She says, this telephone can do anything. She says, look, I can show you the Rolling Stones doing a blues cover on YouTube. I go, whoa, that's new. I says, what else can I find on YouTube? What's big on YouTube? And she says, the biggest thing, she looks up again, the biggest thing this week is a man punching a kangaroo in the face to save his dog. That's neither old nor you, it's just fucking stupid. And, you know, well, what about, what's music's new on YouTube? And she comes up with Pen Pineapple Pen. So that's new. What else can you do with your phone? She says, hipsters actually make music on their phones. I go, what's a hipster? She goes, a bloke with a beard. I say, that's old. But they can make music on their phone. That's new. What I'm trying to get at is that it's complicated because it's all old and it's all new. And I don't know what to think because I'm the adjudicator. I don't have to. All these people have to persuade me and one team is going to win. That's the positive. That's the negative. That's enough of an intro. Perhaps we could introduce the theme more thoroughly in song, Casey. Casey Bennetto.
Two. Yeah. I said a 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Welcome everybody to the SLV. Ain't no finer place to be than a digging the vibe in the library. 7 o'clock, December 8th, right about time for a great debate. Now the library stage is set, it's time to work on my alphabet. I say A, B, A, B, C, gotta bow down to the JVG. Pitt and McCarthy, Sparrow and me against Bigsy, Hickey, Pauly P. Mr. Adjudicator, love me now and I'll pay you later. Be as forgiving as you can as we wrestle with the question, what's new, man? What's new, man? I said, what's new, man? What's new, man? I say, 4, 5, 4, 5, 6, what's Bigsy got in his bag of tricks? I've heard him get his kicks coming down on the collar like a ton of bricks. What you planning, Geraldine? Start a fire, pour gasoline. Why you got to be so mean? Oh, JVG, you got to intervene. Oh no, Pauly P, live wire electricity. Don't you bring that shit to me, or I guarantee they're gonna be debris. Over here, Elizabeth, smart and generous like Jeff. A caravan of the Triple R clan, all thinking through the question, what's new, man? What's new, man? What's new, man? Gotta understand, what's new, man? Mark Gillespie if we can. Everybody said, whoa. Whoa. Oh, that sounded good. All right now. Ladies, gents, pimps, hoes, Jon Von Goes, time to swap this song for prose. They agree, we oppose, let's find out which team really knows. Let's get to talking one by one. Is there nothing new under the sun? We might just end as we began. Still wrestling with the question, what's new, man? What's new, man? What's new, man? What's new, man? Oh, fuck it to me, man.
A fine bipartisan effort, Casey. And nice sampling of only human Mark Gillespie.
Absolutely.
Very well done. Now, okay, everyone's going to have 7 minutes. I've got a bell and it's going to ring after 7 minutes. The first speaker for the affirmative, he's not backward in coming forward with his opinions. He did tell me once when he was thinking of a name for his radio show, he was going to call it Phone and the Barbarian. Oh, that was very good. Please, Tony, the only left-wing shock jock in the country. Don't hold back, will you? Don't hold back. Tony Big.
Ah, Casey, nice to see the insane clown posse has cleaned up a bit. And JVG, actually, the first thing the nurse said when you were cryogenically unfrozen was, I'm not going to change your sheets again, Mr. Von Goes. So, Counterfeit Culture. Is that a bootleg reggae album? Come on, man. 2 7's Clash. Take it from a crazy bald head. Actually, the very idea of Counterfeit Culture, as with everything else in this post-truth world, can be explained by professional wrestling. But as most of you jabronis consider pro wrestling to be lowbrow, if not culturally repugnant, I'll try another tack, one more suited to your refined sensibilities. Officially unqualified, as I am to be speaking in this place, I stand before you simply as a consumer, reflector, and often repudiator of that petri dish of humanity that generates our culture. But just as scientists observe and manipulate those petri dishes, so culture is those customs imposed or begrudgingly tolerated by those in power, which over time become traditions and values. Consequently, for most of recorded history, the culture club, or the church of the poisoned mind, has been the exclusive domain of the dead white male. Many of you will be relieved to know that that domain is one I will be logging on to soon. So even as Western cultural change sped up with the advent of mass media, it was still mediated by the Dead Blokes Society. Rest in peace, Robin Williams. Assholes do vex me. That line's actually a perfect example of which I speak. Robin Williams doing an impression of Jack Nicholson doing William Shakespeare. But it still makes me laugh in the same way that any version of Romeo and Juliet makes me want to puke.
While the rise of mass media did bring about the end of the culture of feudalist politics and religion, physical violence was still needed to force these changes. Because if customs need time to become traditions or culture, the faster any cultural change is assimilated by the mob, the harder the inherently conservative man will try to impede them. Remember, it's never the majority that instigates cultural change. The faster the culture changes, the less time there is for new customs to become a tradition. As that font of wisdom, the great Abraham Simpson, once noted, "We wore onions on our belts as it was the style at the time." Can you see where I'm going with this? If so, can I borrow your glasses? I reckon counterfeit culture is anything the art snobs would classify as postmodern. From Marcel Duchamp to Jeff Koons, from Dylan Thomas to Tarantula, Dali Soul, pop will eat itself. Pop, or popular, meaning appealing to the majority, as well as delineating to the power elite that it's not really culture at all because it's still alive. Nowadays, pop is just the sound you hear when hipsters realise they aren't. I shall now do a trick taught to me by a one-legged sailor who did toffee apple impressions for Frank Thring. That's a reference from a truly culturally subversive radio program called The Goon Show, by the way. And so back to that culture. As David Attenborough would put it, as the plants become nutrition, nutrition becomes waste, waste becomes soil, soil brings forth plants. But to quote Dean and Jean Wein, don't shit where you eat, my friends. That is, I believe, where our culture is now. The pipes may have changed, the monitoring may be audibly and visually high def, but it's the same shit in a quicker turnaround. In agricultural terms, there's less nourishment in the cycle each time. As Homer Simpson said to the rice cake, hello, hello taste. In cultural terms, it means there's less substance, thin gruel indeed. Here's Steel Panther. More please, sir. The good point about cultural change in the last century is the emergence of the rest of humanity into the dead white bloke's domain. Still, if in doing so, the formerly imposed culture has been rebadged a sector, or worse, an industry, we now find ourselves in the pathetic situation where, as Simon Reynolds points out, the big job prospect in the creative economy of the 21st century is curator of anything. Because if you can curate it, it might culturally have a less Warholian shelf life than those paintings by John Wayne Gacy. In a similar mindset, with more new music being recorded and made available than any time in human history, digital natives are increasingly heading back in musical time. It's the now so pervasive, it's unconscious knowledge that new music is made from, or is a fifth generation dilution of, music that's already there. In other words, the immediate thought, subliminal or not, is what shit are these people on? Better go back and check out what they've been eating. Or as Jerry Hall said of Wendy Deng, I'll have what she's having. Seriously, marry this rancid pile of flesh and bone because our culture says he's worth billions. Musically though, if you've programmed a computer to make a beat you've never heard of, and you label it, I don't know, drum and bass, and it actually sounds like a Billy Cobham album from 1972, where's the advance except in the delivery? In David Nicholls' new book, Dig, he describes museums as places that repackage the past to make their version look unassailable by dint, and I love that term, by dint, of selective accumulation of hard evidence. That selective accumulation has spread to libraries, galleries, historians, and even music festivals. As more people, with the covert enabling of social media, become their own curators, there's less and less chance that an overarching culture will ever have time to become established. The finest and scariest example of this is the US election. Incidentally, why does Trump keep using "you can't always get what you want" at his rallies? Do the stones care, or are they being paid? Actually, as any pupil at the London School of Economics would tell you, the stones have never cared. That's their whole point. Now, what do the US elections say to you about American culture? Or, as we're constantly told while we bend over like rhesus monkeys, the values our country so deeply hold and share? Was it that Americans are a bunch of racist alfoil hat wearers? Only some. Was it that Americans are a bunch of feminists and non-whites eager for equality? Only some. What I think the election showed is that the majority of Americans, and remember, we supposedly share these same cultural attributes, are apathetic zombie consumers so anesthetized they couldn't even roll off the couch to vote. So if our shared ideals, our values, our culture is based on ideas of democracy and freedom, America, fuck yeah! What of that culture if the majority doesn't want it? Better curate a democracy exhibit before the music stops. But that's history to be contested like everything else. Now, with the individual ability to selectively accumulate hard evidence to infinity via the web, the past is the present, the future is in 10 minutes, the personal is the political, truth is what I believe it is, and all culture is counterfeit. As the great philosopher David Lee Roth said, we're totally lost, but we're well ahead of schedule.
It seems that the bell will mean it's time to wind it up. Thank you, Tony. Jeff Sparrow. He's an author. He's a journo. He's a broadcaster. He's a breakfaster. The other thing I need to point out is there's a breakfaster on the other team. And it could get ugly. Give it up for Jeff.
Thanks, JV. Thanks to all of you guys for coming out. 2016, it hasn't been the greatest year, has it? If we can't agree on anything else, perhaps we can agree on that. The way I've been thinking about it to myself, Leonard Cohen, dead, Pauline Hanson, still alive. But one thing that we have got out of this year is a fairly definitive answer to the question that we're discussing tonight. Because if any of you, ladies and gentlemen, are confronted by someone putting forward the proposition that our opponents here are asserting, that there's nothing new under the sun, after the experience of 2016, you have a fairly straightforward two-word response to shut them down. The first word is president, the second word is Trump. This is the year of Donald Trump, and I think a lot of people have gone through the five Kubler-Ross stages of grieving about the state of politics in the world today and have arrived at a kind of acceptance of the reality in which we're now living, which is fine. You do what you have to do. But I think what that does is it blinds us to how novel these times actually are. And to try and bring that out for you, I'd like to imagine a scenario, a civics class, say, an American civics class. You've got little Chad and little Stacy. They're learning about American history and their presidents. There's President Washington famously said, "I cannot tell a lie." President Lincoln said that government of the people, for the people, by the people, shall not fade from the earth. President Roosevelt, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. President Kennedy, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. President Trump, grab them by the pussy. I think little Stacy, little Chad would realize that one of these things is not like the others, that the culture has changed somewhat over the last year. And look, I understand why people would want to say that nothing has changed, that the times are the same as they always have been, because it's comforting, it's reassuring to think the world is still the same, particularly in frightening times like this. I used to work in literary publishing, an industry that felt like it was a kind of slow motion car crash as jobs were being shed left, right and centre. And it wasn't that books were no longer being published, it was just that the kind of books that were being published were not the books that we liked. They were cricketers' diaries, and that they were celebrity cookbooks, and they were film tie-ins. And everyone I knew in the industry, there was a particular quote from the Roman orator Cicero that people used to circulate to try and reassure themselves. You might have heard it. It's attributed to Cicero. It goes, "Times are bad, children no longer obey their parents, and everybody is writing a book." And this made us all feel better because we thought, okay, the times are just the same as if we were in ancient Rome. And of course, the problem with that was, well, there are two problems. The first problem is, of course, Cicero didn't say anything of the sort. It's a made-up quote that people found on the internet. But the second quote, the second problem is it didn't really explain the difficulty of the situation that we found ourselves in. It wasn't just that everybody was writing a book. It was that everybody was writing a book and they were telling you all about it on Twitter with the hashtag #amwriting, and they were Snapchatting pictures of the launch using that stupid filter that puts the crowns on people's heads. This was a problem that Cicero never had to deal with. If someone tried to Snapchat Cicero, he would have had them crucified. So I think the comparison with the ancient world is one well worth making. I was just reading something the other day, a data scientist who was talking about, we're in a library here, but was talking about the library of ancient Alexandria. And at the time, it was thought to contain all the information that was known in the civilized world was supposed to be in this library. And this computer boffin pointed out that if you converted that information to data, we have today some 2,300 billion times more data available to us than they had in ancient Egypt 300 BC. Or to put it another way, if you downloaded all of the content of the internet onto a CD-ROM and stacked them all, you'd end up with five towers of CDs that all reached to the moon. And again, you see, one of these things is not like another. Now, you may be saying, look, it's not about size, it's about what you do with it, which, as I say, that feels like it's an argument that's come into from a different discussion. But leaving that aside, let's talk about the different way that we use data compared to the ancient world, because I think it's quite revelatory of how different the world is today. Imagine that you were transported back in time and you found yourself in ancient Egypt, 300 BC, the Library of Alexandria, and the librarian was showing you all around and showing you all the papyrus, all the great knowledge that we have here. You'd be able to respond by pulling out your mobile phone. And of course, your mobile phone enables you to access data millions of times more than is in this library, as I've just been discussing. And of course, the librarian would be tremendously impressed by this and would say to you, what a magical device. And what do you people in the future do with this magical device in this great future that you're all living? I suppose that you all use it to ponder the great questions of humanity, questions of epistemology and ontology and theology, all of those questions. And of course, statistically, what do we use the internet for? Well, firstly, we use it for pornography, and secondly, we use it for social media. And so you would have to respond to the librarian, yeah, statistically, we use it for masturbating and for getting into fights with strangers. Whereupon the librarian would say, what a time to be alive. And that's the point that I wanted to make, that the future isn't all that it was promised to be. Orwell famously said, if you want an image of the future, imagine a boot standing on a face forever and ever. That's not our future, is it? If you wanted a picture of our future, imagine Donald Trump masturbating on Twitter forever and ever. That's the future that we've made for ourselves. And the problem with saying this is a counterfeit culture and there's nothing new under the sun is we don't face up to how uniquely horrible the situation is that we find ourselves in at the moment. If we ever want to do anything about it, the first step is to face up to it. And that means acknowledging that it's something new. Thanks.
Thank you, Jeff. Would there be any people out there who'd want to ask a question of Jeff or of Tony? Or are they just too dauntingly intellectual? Don't be afraid. A question for Tony, a question for Jeff. We'll move on. I'll be asking the same thing after the next two speakers, so. I'm not going to tell them they win a prize. They've missed out this time. Geraldine,
yes.
You're also a breakfaster.
Yes.
I can tell it's getting heated. She's a sports commentator. She's a comedian, a broadcaster, and a breakfaster. Geraldine Hickey.
Well, here we are. Having a debate. Yeah, like that hasn't happened before. We're debating whether there's anything original left in the world. The fact that this has come up before suggests that the answer is clearly no. Now, Jeff Sparrow just got up and claimed that using President-elect Donald Trump as an example of something new. Hello, a lefty having a whinge about Donald Trump becoming the US president. How original. Oh, we've got mobile phones now. We've got mobile phones, everybody. Let's not confuse culture with technology. Now to begin, counterfeit culture. Is that a bootleg reggae album? Come on, man. 2/7 clutch, taken from a crazy bald head. Actually, sorry, that's yours. sorry. You know how I know that there's nothing new under the sun? Google. Here's in case he started the show with by singing, doing a little bit of a rap, right? A little bit of a white boy rap. Probably thought it was original, but you know what? I could type in white boy doing crap rap and watch the hits roll in. There is nothing new under the sun, and you know what? That's okay. Because sometimes things are just better when somebody else does it. A cover of any Bob Dylan song is a perfect example. Ooh, controversial. Geraldine, you're a comedian. Surely you write your own jokes. Surely you wouldn't steal other people's material and pass it off as your own. Yes, many, many times. I've done it before and I will do it again. Now here's the thing, I'm quite a competitive person and together with my teammates, we will fight to win this debate. We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills, we shall never surrender. Okay, seems a bit extreme, but if I fail, if I succeed, at least I'll live as I believe. No matter what they take from me, they can't take away my dignity. They may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom. Will it be easy? No, not really, because we chose to go to the moon. We chose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, because they are hard. But to be honest, we probably should have concentrated on winning this debate. How do you win? It ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. I get knocked down, but I get back up again. You're never going to keep me down. I'm a survivor. I ain't going to give up. Keep on surviving. Hate is going to hate. Hate. Hate, hate, hate. baby, I'm just going to shake, 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 shake it off. I'm moving on up. You're moving on out. Nothing can stop me. You can't fight the moonlight. You can't buy me love. You can't hurry love. Love is in the air and I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. Got to testify, come up in the spot looking extra fly. For the day I die, I'ma touch the sky. Now, I know the other team will argue that I've just gotten up here and said a bunch of quotes. And they're right. I have. But I'm not the first to win an argument by plagiarism, and I certainly won't be the last. Now, I must admit I've witnessed members of the other team stressing over what they're going to write for this debate, knowing that they need to come up with something original. I cannot tell you how much joy I had in sitting back and saying, oh, really? I find this thing kind of writes itself. From a young age, my parents impressed on me the values that you work hard for what you want in life, that your word is your bond, and you do what you say and you keep your promise, that you treat people with respect. They taught and showed me values and morals in their daily life. That is a lesson I continue to pass along to my dogs, Lloyd and Harry. And we need to pass those lessons on to the many generations to follow, because we want our children in this nation to know that the only limit is to your achievements is the strength of your dreams and your willingness to work for them. I'm also just a girl standing in front of a boy asking him to love her. To the other team, you've got to ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky? Well, do you? Punk. So in conclusion, that'll do, pig, that'll do.
Thank you, Geraldine. Response, Elizabeth McCarthy. She's the talks producer at Triple R. She's got a show called Multi-Storied. She once told me the best thing she ever did in radio was stop interviewing musicians and to start interviewing authors because they're a whole lot more interesting. Elizabeth.
Okay, so there is plenty new and authentic under the sun. You've just got to open your eyes and prepare to be blinded. Saturday, April 23rd, 2016 will go down in history as one of those days when you were either wandering around with a bucket over your head, not seeing anything out of the ordinary, slash hanging about with your head buried in the sand, not seeing anything out of the ordinary, or slash staring hard and long into your 21st century mobile device, for the news was shocking, the news was brand new. The news was that great art had been dropped from high above, from the penthouse suite of Parkwood Entertainment, New York City, and the art called itself Lemonade, and the artist was Beyoncé. You know, sometimes you're walking through life with a teeny little frown on your in your brow, and as life goes on, that teeny little frown starts to resemble an obstinate little question mark, and that obstinate little question mark in the centre of your once dewy, carefree little face is asking questions like, how did I get here? Where does that highway go to? How do I work this? Where is that large automobile? This is not my beautiful house. This is not my beautiful wife. My God, what have I done? Saturday, April 23rd, 2016 was when an artistic intervention occurred upon the question marks of our times. Lemonade came with little warning. Its first single formation dropped in February. Then for a while, nothing, no sound. Then months of painstaking, highly secretive, security-guarded art-making by the leader of the pack, Queen Bey, arrived in one jaw-dropping art slab, An album, a film, a testimony of a marriage under strain, and a political manifesto set to the oldest universal language of our times, music. And how shocking it was, this masterpiece called Lemonade. Some sections of white America were so shocked by it, they boycotted a chain restaurant called Red Lobster. On the standout track of Lemonade, Formation, Bay casually mentions that if her man fucks her good, she takes his ass to Red Lobster. A shrimps and salad reward for showing her a good time. White America didn't like the sound of, say, of Bay's good time, so in a fit of outrage, some boycotted that chain restaurant and got their goddamn serve of crab bisque elsewhere. Bay did not flinch. Because is there anything worse than an artist making art and then apologising for making that art because the people cannot cope? Bay saw the shock that Formation fermented, but she did not flinch. Instead, she surrounded herself with a gang of female dancers, swathed them, the lot of them, in Black Panther-esque costuming, and hit the freaking Super Bowl with a halftime all-singing, all-dancing extravaganza to get her message across. It was Black History Month in America, and it was bloody time for it. Black Lives Matter was growing. It was the last year of the second term of the first Black American president, and it was about time. Because parading your fearless, brave-ass politics in the half-hour show of a multinational sports empire is a highly calculated, strategically planned artistic intervention over the question marks that hang over our times. Who would have thought that a talented little girl from Texas could grow up to be the biggest pop star in the world? Who could have predicted that while working her gifted, glorious ass off for stadium status, she was also experiencing a personal and political awakening that she didn't want to hide from her fans, but wanted to ramp up, to reveal, to drop all the way down from the penthouse suite of Parkwood Entertainment, New York City, an artwork that is an intervention on the question marks that we're all staggering around with. Those few who become the biggest pop stars in the world tend to dilute whatever political messages or leanings they start out their hopeful careers with. This is how the story usually plays out. Sometimes they'll write one or two meandering mid-career tunes that let their old lefty mates know that they still care about stuff, sorta. They'll parade this song around as if their heart still belongs amongst the true believing soul of the earth types, those they once hung around, bought rounds with, did the rounds with. Lemonade is a mid-career artwork that is not like this. Album number 6 from Bay. Lemonade acknowledges history but looks formidably to the future. Is there anything new under the sun, you ask? Yes, there is. There is plenty. One of those things is called lemonade, and if you go deep, deep into it, its sun will blind you. One of Australia's long-standing unofficial poet laureates, Don Walker, has in his time written a couple of songs that have upset people. K-San was an artistic intervention on the nebulous narrative of the Vietnam War experience. It was banned when it was released as a single, and at the time slapped with an official A classification, which meant not suitable for airplay. The reasons given were the song's sex and drug references, but really it wasn't just the depiction of sex and drugs that censors quivered over. It was the big fat question marks the lyrics raised about why the hell Australia went to war in Vietnam. K-San sprayed a generous helping of tomato sauce onto your bread and sausage and then dropped it on the ground, ground it around and held it up right under the sun and said, fuck this for a joke. No one boycotted chain restaurants over cold chisel, though. Chisel upset the censors, the squares in commercial radio, the Catholic Church and the ABC, but not the restaurant goers. Don Walker said in an interview a few years ago that he sees rock and roll as, quote, a relatively new art form. I see hip-hop as an art form with its potential barely cracked open. Its tools are as potent as ever, the word and the dance floor. I see the world's biggest pop star, Beyoncé, just starting to carve herself out a brand new space. Her space is wide open. It's 100% authentic and it is right under the sun. Lemonade is its starting point. If you didn't notice anything different on April 23rd this year, then you need to take some time out very soon for a long, tall glass of lemonade and a big spiritual and cultural shakedown right under the sun.
Heating up. Do we have a... Can we get a microphone to the lady with the large hair up the back?
It's Kate.
Of course it is.
Thank you. I'm really enjoying this debate. And I guess my question is to Geraldine. Could you please quote some lyrical quotes from the album Lemonade?
From Lemonade? You want me to do some quotes from Lemonade? Yep, get in formation. My Louisiana mama, my Alabama, something, get in formation. Formation. I'm a queen, and I slay. Yes, I slay.
Spot on, right?
And Kate gets a prize. 30 years of Triple R. That's been on air for 40 years. Anything new in those last 10 years?
Talking
I'm talking to the both of you. Question for Elizabeth?
Why don't you quote some lemonade?
That's a pretty good question.
You really seem
to like lemonade, Elizabeth.
Who the fuck do you think I am?
Hello.
You ain't married no average bitch, boy.
Can I ask why white girls rapping don't get the same shit white boys do?
Oh, it does.
Oh, you can ask.
Haven't heard it here yet, Geraldine.
I'll take that as a statement, Tony. Pauly P, hang on. He comes from Bundoora. He's got a wife and four kids. He coaches sport down the front here, the four kids, the wife. Saturday nights, he turns into something different. He comes into Triple R. He presents a show that has a lot of live music on it for those people who would like to go out but really prefer to stay home and listen to live music. He is a voice of rock. Debating, we can find out. Pauly P.
Thank you, John. How do I follow that? The way you taught me. Speak as slow as I can to fill 7 minutes. Thanks for everyone coming tonight. Are you all right? Can you hear me okay? Yep. Okay. Counterfeit culture. Is that a bootleg reggae album? No, there's clearly nothing new under the sun. I think you've all got half a brain and you can realise that the question is totally ridiculous, isn't it? Because I really can't understand it. There seems to be a lot of new ideas. There's always something new coming out, but I think if you've been around a little while or you know something about other things, there's always something borrowed, used, or blatantly stolen that always gets... it's forgotten through the generations that a lot of people don't want you to know that it could have come from somewhere else. Has that ever happened? Yes, thank you. A lot of music, film and TV is created, but mostly we are saturated by music samples, blockbuster movie remakes, and rehashed political opinions. I want to mention the 1976 classic case. George Harrison was found guilty of subconscious plagiarism, whatever that means. He wrote a song called My Sweet Lord, and it was proven that he subconsciously plagiarised the Chiffons' hit He's So Fine. And from then on, I'm confused out of the whole music industry because I think nearly every single song reminds me of something else. In 1979, Debbie Harry wrote a song with Nigel Harrison called One Way or Another. In 2013, a band called One Direction had to release a song for comic relief, which wouldn't have been too hard, I wouldn't have thought. But they re-released a song called One Way or Another and Teenage Kicks from the Undertones. So if this couldn't get any worse, I got into a full-on argument when this song came out with a 12-year-old gang of my kids' friends who, when I had the Blondie version playing in our backyard barbecue, a kid said, "Who is doing this terrible version of the One Direction song?" I had to control myself. I saw the age and the situation. I said, "It's Blondie." And this kid said to me, "I prefer the real one." And I think this is the point, that if you haven't heard the secret first, it's not really a secret after you've heard it. So that's all I can say, perhaps. Because you don't know where everything came from. Does anyone know where everything came from? No. How are we going, John? I've just got a few observations that I've made over the years. Andy Warhol, very famous artist. Is any Andy Warhol fans here? So funny about that. But he had borrowed ideas. He decided to paint Campbell's soup cans and pictures of Marilyn and Elvis, and everybody appeals to those figures. So half of his work's already done, the way I see it. In conclusion, I've just met Jeff Sparrow tonight. I've never met him before. We're clearly at opposite ends of the sun. But I do like how he's a new member to a show that has gone under the banner of Breakfasters for 30 years. Is there any reason they haven't changed that? Just to keep you all... Well, half your work's done. Everyone's going to listen to the Breakfasters. They don't even know you're on it. And my good friend Elizabeth over here, we shared a car down to the Meredith Music Festival once, and she did proclaim her love for the band known as GNF&R. It's Guns N' Roses. Did you like them when Buckethead was in the band, Elizabeth? So you're a purist. Appetite for Destruction. So the band still evolves, but not the way you see it. It's just the original form. See, that's the idea of it, what we're talking about. And as for Casey, I've never met Casey before either, but the way I see it is he sings about ideas that we all know with a catchy song behind it that we might know, and we're going to applaud him. No. Sorry, Casey. Your name's original. I know that. I've never met another Casey Bennetto. Well, look, in conclusion... Thanks, John. I don't know what else to say. I think that everybody's stolen most of my good points. So I'll sit down, but there is nothing new under the sun.
Thank you, Pauly. The Triple R listeners would know that My Sweet Lord was covered at barbecue day a few years back. My meat thawed. Speaking of Barbecue Day, one of the stars of Barbecue Day, Casey Bennetto, has one of my favourite shows on Triple R, not wishing to sort of say that the other people's shows are less, but Superfluity is a fabulous show. Sometimes I sit in my chair and do nothing else but listen to Casey's voice. Casey Bennetto.
Thank you, beloved adjudicator. Esteemed teammates, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorely tempted to begin simply by pointing to our adversaries in this debate, for this evening they have successfully proven our point. Talk about new, talk about innovative. I'd wager there has never been a more confused, incompetent, intellectually barren argument mounted by a debating team in the history of debating. So as antithetical as it is to their cause, I must first congratulate them on their achievement. Indeed, you might be forgiven for thinking that the unconvincing line run by these folks on my left stems from a lack of belief on their part. Whether it's Tony Biggs, who in his opening to On the Blower just last Friday trumpeted to listeners that he had a fistful of new things to play, Pauly P, co-host of Livewire, a show literally dedicated to the transcendence and singularity of the moment at hand, or Geraldine Hickey, who approximately 22 hours ago at the Wheeler Centre Show of the Year was doing push-ups and running laps of the Athenaeum stage dressed in a green and gold tracksuit as Survivor's Eye of the Tiger played. The audience unanimously agreed they had never seen anything like it. So you could easily understand their sort of half-heartedness, you know, glossed over with bluster, as some kind of indicator of their collective shame at their own hypocrisy tonight. For make no mistake, these people believe in the new. They believe in cultural change. They bemoan how hard it is to achieve on the issues they care about, but they believe in it nonetheless. No matter what they say, you know they do not hold with that arch-conservative, cynical ideology first outlined in Ecclesiastes 1, there is nothing new under the sun. In fact, the immediately preceding verse in that chapter of the Bible says, all things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. The ear never has its fill of hearing, and that's supposed to be a bad thing. These are not the words of a true supporter of Triple R. This is the message of someone who has given up on life, an austereo network hack, perhaps. All is vanity, everything is meaningless. A triple play from Nickelback right after the break. Now, do works of art influence other works of art? Of course. I mean, on Triple R, I co-host Superfluity, as Jon Von Goes mentioned, a show explicitly devoted to making those connections, but they are connections between different works of art with different things to offer. The show couldn't exist without those differences. To suggest that a work of art is not new simply because it's been influenced is to align oneself with those table thumpers complaining about the Sugar Hill Gang in 1979, or equating Jackson Pollock to a child's endeavours in the 1950s. It is a reflex born of fear and suspicion, and it's more about maintaining an air of superiority than it is about opening your eyes and ears to the art in front of you. Now, this is not to say that Triple R is necessarily a stranger to that kind of behaviour. There are some who would say that community radio in general is the natural home of, oh, I prefer their earlier albums, and I liked them before they were popular. But both of those statements have at their heart a love for the new. The dissatisfaction with a band's later, more predictable work comes directly from the desire to be challenged again, to be surprised, to be shocked, to be taken aback, to embrace the possibility of reinvention, the desire to be renewed. So it's worth addressing that pathetic fig leaf of semantics right now that was raised by Pauly P there. Recycling, repurposing, sampling, reimagining. These concepts are not contradictory to the process of creation. They are at the very heart of it. We take what we are given and we make something new. How far would this team advance down that road of objection? Are sentences just made of words that have already existed and therefore are all hopelessly derivative? I think we can all agree that's a desperately schnarlnifitrous position to take. But more literally, everything is new under the sun. Everything is in a different light, seen from a different angle, by eyes that are themselves different than they were yesterday. When Gillian Welch and David Rawlings first appeared, there was a great deal of harumphing about their sort of ersatz Appalachian folk being carted about by these Californian pretenders. And now the sun and the shadows have shifted. And rather than being a falsification, they're a wellspring of music from which other artists draw. And I'm sure those who once rail against them now rail against their imitators. Time is indeed a revelator, which is to say, it reveals the new in what we thought was settled. Now you say, yeah, That's all very well, but it's still the same thing that it was yesterday. That's a failure not only of imagination, but of vision and awareness itself. It is not the same thing. You are not the same person, except Bigsy. Bigsy is kind of the same person he was yesterday. I leave it to you to conclude whether that's the proper way to live. In fact, the arguments of our opponents in general are at heart so old world, so prehistoric, so hopelessly antediluvian that they would present us as being under the sun. Do we need to add flat earther to the list of characteristics represented tonight? Clearly already there's no such thing as climate change, gender fluidity, social progress of any kind. The passage in Ecclesiastes ends up encouraging us not to worry about these things, but to live simply. These folks on my left appear to have taken that as a mental instruction. I urge you all not to do the same. Instead, embrace diversity, which is to say, embrace the different. Be courageous. Reject the pernicious politics of fear and suspicion, the cruelly cynical ethos that says everything is meaningless and nothing can ever change. Instead, let's go back a few years further than Ecclesiastes. Let's look to the great Greek philosopher Heraclitus, who tells us the only constant is change, and who says you cannot step twice into the same river. Now, all of these principles, the importance of alternative points of view, the role of passion and innovation and invention in art, the desire to challenge and confront and enlighten, and the belief that the world is always changing and always new, have been at the very core of Triple R's identity for 40 proud years now. Therefore, I implore you, brothers and sisters, do not side with these forces of darkness and despair, these retrograde purveyors of scorn and skepticism. Step into this river, strip off that defensive hide, scrub yourself with the holy loofah of invigorating art, and emerge from the water glistening, vibrant, newborn. Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? Hallelujah!
You will have right to reply shortly. Yes. A question for Pauly or Casey? Yes. Can we have a microphone down the front here, please? A question for?
For this team.
Pauly?
I'm just wondering if this has shaken your resolve. Has shaken your resolve.
I don't understand the question. No, clearly not.
It's a fine question, and it was too highbrow for him. And you will get a prize. A question for Casey, who would dare? Yes, please, can we have a microphone to the gentleman over there, please?
Casey, I was just wondering if you could publish that somewhere, the speech. It was actually quite stirring.
That's the kind of question I really like to take.
Is it a yes?
Yes, my friend, yes. It will be published in tablets of stone, carted down the mountaintop to Brunswick East.
In summing up, you're going to have to vote soon, so think about it. Oh, all right. Who to? Please, a microphone to the middle. Is it just because you want a prize?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But that's not original. No. That's not new. To this team here, I was wondering if you could answer, is there anything new about running around an Athenaeum doing athletics?
Geraldine, it's for you.
Sorry, the question was, is there anything new about running around the Athenaeum in athletics gear?
Doing athletics around something named something very Greek.
Sure. Yeah, I see where you're going with this.
Yeah. And, you see.
thinking that, no, that's not new at all. I don't think it's new to dress up in a costume in a theatre and be silly, because that's exactly what I was doing, and I nailed it.
A prize for the gentleman down the front. Tony, in summing up?
Well, in summing up, could I point out how pathetic Australian audiences are whenever it comes to Q&As? Seriously.
We want them on side, Pixie.
Seriously. No, no, I've seen it with Kim Gordon. I saw it with Diamond Dallas Page. Any questions? And people just go...
They're voting for us. What are you doing?
Oh, they're voting for us. Oh. Well, you know, if Casey's going to run his mouth off with these quotes from 2,000 and 3,000-year-old books about how there's everything new under the sun, Biggs 316 says, we just kicked your ass.
A right of reply and summing up?
Sure, I'm not going to follow the curious tactic of insulting all the audience who are going to vote for us. We think you're a great audience. So. So in conclusion, I'd like to say we have the Bible on our side and Beyonce, and we think you're terrific. They hate you. Vote for us.
Could I have a show of hands? Show of hands. Remember, you're going to have to vote. You can only vote once, or you don't have to vote at all, but you can't vote twice. A show of hands for the negative.
There's millions of illegal voters.
Do we need a show of hands for you?
Yeah, come on.
It's not that much of a thrashing. Can we give it up for the positives? And may the winners be upstanding, please. And can the negatives be upstanding, please? Thank you very much, Triple R audience, listeners, State Library people. The bar will be open for a little bit longer. And thanks so much for coming. Congratulations to both teams, and this one just a little bit more.